Amen.
God bless.
Yes, Lord. Praise God. Praise Him.
We thank you for coming today. Thank God for all of those that are out.
Amen.
Thank you, Lord.
Hopefully, if the Lord say the same, I can be here every Sunday.
Right.
The Sundays that I don't go visit my wife.
Yes.
Yes.
We never know from Sunday to Sunday who's going to preach. We have three preachers here, and the Lord can do whatever He want to do.
Yes.
The spirit of truth is the spirit of truth, no matter whose mouth is coming out of.
Amen.
And so, you know, it's not, we don't have any set schedules.
All right, bro.
At all. You know, as soon as you think you can put the Lord on the program, you done lost Him.
That's right.
Because He's too big to be put on your piece of paper.
Yes.
So, the Lord will do what He want. All right. So we thank God for you all coming out today.
Amen.
And I ask that you remember Mother May in your prayers.
Amen.
You know, she hides her pain real well.
Yeah.
And you never know what's really going on the inside of people sometimes, because they don't want to bring other people down and make you feel bad about them. You know, make you feel bad for them, but.
Yes.
Just if we love one another like what we're supposed to, then we're supposed to feel the same pain that she's feeling.
Yes.
We're supposed to act like we got that pain.
Yes.
Because if we were hurting like that, we know we'd be on our knees before the Lord.
Yes.
Praying about it.
Amen.
So let's act like that's us.
Amen.
You know, that's what the body is.
Amen.
That's what the body is. So let's not just, you know, and you know, if she's feeling bad, let's look into what we can do for her.
Yeah.
You know, let's look into, let's not just talk. Let's look into what we can do for her.
Yeah.
You know, it's more to being a Christian than talking it.
Yes.
You know, if you're part of that, I saw on TV the other night, a woman that didn't have any arms.
All right.
And she had a little bitty baby. She could change that baby's diaper with her feet. Could change the diaper. She was driving with her feet, had a driver's license to drive with her feet. I'm saying that to say, when one member of the body is down, the other members are supposed to pick it up.
Yeah.
Supposed to pick up the slack.
Yeah,
and so let's try to help out where we can.
Yeah.
And let's help one another and love one another.
Because
that's how the world knows that we're the sons of God.
Yeah.
It's by love.
Yeah.
All right. You have your Bibles, turn to the 17th chapter of Jeremiah. The 17th chapter of Jeremiah. While you're going out, I'll explain a little bit. There's a condition in man, male or female. Sometimes they might eat the wrong things during their life, you know, especially fattening foods. And what happens is your arteries get to clogging up.
Yes.
And it'll get your heart. It makes, when your arteries start clogging up, it's just like taking a water hose and turning the water on and squeezing it. It makes your heart pump harder.
Yeah.
And by your heart pumping harder and working harder, that your heart muscle begins to expand and gets bigger and bigger.
Yeah.
And so that, what that does, and you get blockages in your arteries, and what that does is it makes your heart, it puts basically your heart on the timeline. You know, it puts your heart on the timeline where, and doctors call it heart disease.
Yeah.
Your heart is working so vividly to try to pump that blood, and it's getting more or less than what it's able to put out.
Yeah.
And so, you know, of course, your extremities get to feeling, you know, where you can't feel anything through your extremities. Well, the doctors call it heart disease.
Yeah.
Because the heart ain't treating the blood right.
Amen.
And so that's the title of my sermon today, Heart Disease in the Body of Christ.
Amen.
Because some of us want to some of us won't receive it, the way it's supposed to be received. Now, if you would turn to the 17th chapter of Jeremiah, we'll start reading at the 9th verse. And it reads, "The heart is deceitful above all things." Does that say all or some?
All
things. "And desperately wicked. Who can know it?" You know, that's a real big statement. The heart is deceitful above all things. That means your heart will have you thinking you're going to heaven when you headed for the lake of fire. That's heart disease in the body of Christ. It'll have you thinking. I know plenty of people that think they all right. Jeremiah said it, "and desperately wicked. Who can know it?" Verse 10 says, "I, the Lord, search the heart. I try the reins, even to give every man according to his ways and according to the fruit." Everybody say fruit.
Fruit
of his doing. Why? Because the heart is where the fruit begins at.
All right.
Yes.
All right.
If your heart is right, you're going to be right. All right. When Jesus came on the scene, let's look at the 12th chapter of Matthew. I want to just give you an example of what happens when people's hearts aren't right. The 12th chapter of St. Matthew. We'll start reading at the first verse. It says, "At that time, Jesus went on the Sabbath day through the corn, and his disciples were anhungered and began to pluck the ears of the corn and to eat. But when the Pharisees saw it, they said unto him, Behold, thy disciples do that which is not lawful to do on the Sabbath day." I want you to know something. We need to realize that the Pharisees were the religious people of their day. They were the church of their day. And here, the King of all kings is doing something. And they think, and they have the nerve to try to reprove him. Why? Because their hearts wasn't right. If their hearts was right, they would know who they were talking to. The Lord of the Sabbath. And the problem is, when your heart ain't right, it's like looking through shades with a tent on them. You never see things the way they really are.
Right.
Why? Because the heart is what receives the word of God.
Amen.
The heart is what receives the word of God. Let's keep reading. Verse 3 says, "But he said unto them, Have ye not read what David did when he was a-hungered, and they that were with him? How he entered into the house of God and did eat the showbread, which was not lawful for him to eat, neither for them which were with him, but only for the priests? Or have ye not read in the law how that on the Sabbath days the priests in the temple profane the Sabbath and are blameless? But I say unto you that in this place is one greater than the temple. But if ye had known what this mean, I will have mercy and not sacrifice you. Ye would not have condemned the guiltless. For the Son of Man is the Lord even of the Sabbath day." I want to read verse 6 again. "But I say unto you that in this place is one greater than the temple. But if ye had known what that mean, I will have mercy and not sacrifice. Ye would not have condemned the guiltless." See, because their hearts weren't right. They weren't able to see Jesus. They didn't know who Jesus was. At the most, they thought Jesus might have been the prophet. At the most. Now, the same people, I want you to catch this, the Pharisees were responsible for this book back then. They were the ones that interpreted the words of God. But when your heart ain't right, you won't see the word of God.
Amen.
It's hid from you.
Yeah.
And you can memorize this whole Bible from Genesis to Revelations. That don't make you have God in your heart.
Amen.
That don't make you have God in your heart. When Jesus came to this earth, he didn't go to the Pharisees to gather disciples. He went to unlearned men.
Amen.
Why? Because he could put the word of God in them.
Right.
The Pharisees were too full of themselves.
Yeah.
So the word of God wouldn't fit up in there.
Right.
And we still got a bunch of Pharisees today.
Yes.
Verse 9 says, and when he was departed there, he went into their synagogue. Now, I want you to notice that. It says he went into their synagogue. Isn't that strange? I thought that was supposed to have been his synagogue. But they were running the show in there. Just like church today. God ain't no way in there. God can't be in our mess. We can't put him out on our programs. If God can't operate freely in our lives, he can't dwell there. Because you can't hand God a list of things that you're willing to do and not do. Verse 10 says, and behold, there was a man which had his hand withered. And they asked him, saying, is it lawful to heal on the Sabbath days? That they might accuse him. Now, that shows you how wicked Ben's heart can be. Who wouldn't feel for a person that was sick or that had something wrong with them? But all they could think about is the law.
Amen.
All they could think about was the law.
Amen.
When your heart ain't right, love ain't there.
Amen.
It ain't there.
Amen.
All right, let's keep reading. Verse 11 says, and he said unto them, what man shall there be among you that shall have one sheep? And if it fall into a pit on the Sabbath day, will he not lay hold on it and lift it out? How much then is a man better than a sheep? Wherefore it is lawful to do well on the Sabbath days. Verse 13 says, then he said to the man, stretch forth thine hand. And he stretched it forth, and it was restored whole like as the other.
Amen.
Then the Pharisees went out and held a council against him, how they might destroy him. Now, if their heart was right, they'd have been rejoicing. Because here is one of their brothers got a withered hand. They were powerless and couldn't do anything about it. And when somebody come along with power that could do something, that could move, they're ready to kill him. That's a wicked heart. That's a wicked heart. And it's still that way today. When God, you just keep living. Let God do something for you, and you go tell somebody what God is doing for you. They'll swell up on the inside. Because in their back of their mind, they're thinking, well, why God ain't doing that for me? They ain't going to rejoice with you. Why? Because they're not your brother. They don't care nothing about you or what God is doing for you. All they're thinking about is me. Why God ain't doing nothing for me? Why? Because your heart ain't right. If you get your heart right and rejoice when God is doing stuff for other people, he'll do things for you. All right. All right, let's move down to verse 33. In the same chapter, chapter 12, verse 33, it says, either make the tree good and his fruit good, or else make the tree corrupt and his fruit corrupt. For the tree is known by his fruits. Now, I was saying this morning in Sunday school, you can't tell me that you're an apple tree and I'm looking at oranges. You can't do it. Whatever is in your heart, whatever is planted there, that's what's going to spring up.
Yeah.
That's what's going to spring up.
Good.
All right, let's keep reading. I don't want to get too far into that right now. It says, O generation of vipers, how can ye, being evil, speak good things? For out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh.
Amen.
If you ever want to know, if you don't know yourself, if you ever want to know what you got on the inside, just get you a tape recorder.
All right.
Yeah.
All right.
Because you're going to tell on yourself. Whatever is in your heart, that's what's coming out of your mouth. And take that a step further. Whatever you're sowing in your heart is going to come out of your mouth.
Yes.
Whatever you're sowing in your heart is going to come out of your mouth.
Right.
You keep watching that stuff on HBO. You're going to be talking like the people on HBO.
Right.
The Bible says, be not deceived. Evil communication corrupt good manners.
Amen.
If you want to be righteous, you hang around people that's righteous.
Yes, sir. Amen.
Amen.
Verse 35 says, a good man out of a good treasure of the heart bringeth forth good things, and an evil man out of the evil treasure bringeth forth evil things. But I say unto you that every idle word that men shall speak, they shall give an account thereof in the day of judgment. For by thy words thou shalt be justified, and by thy words thou shalt be condemned. So we need to be careful on what we let get put into our hearts.
Yes.
We have two ways that we can receive things, through the eyes, through the ears. Whatever you let go through both of them, it's going to manifest.
Yes.
It's going to manifest later on.
Yes.
I'm a living witness.
Amen.
You know, if you listen to all kind of junk and all this other stuff, it's going to start manifesting.
Yes.
That's why pretty soon you'll start acting like the people you're hanging around.
Yes.
You can't get past what Jesus said here. That's why it get me when Christians want to hang around with people that they know are of the world. Because most of the time, the spirit that's in them is stronger than the spirit that's in you. And you thinking you can help them, you done deceived yourself. You thinking you can help them when all along, and you thinking you pulling them when all along they pulling you. So before you do that, you better make sure that you're rooted and grounded. All right, let's turn to the 15th chapter of St. Matthew. We'll start reading at the first verse. Now, before I start, let me just say this. I did an in-depth study on this heart stuff, and it's a whole lot the Bible have to say about the heart. And just about everywhere I see the Bible talking about the heart, the mouth is right behind it.
Amen.
You turn to Proverbs, the mouth is always right behind the heart. Because whatever is in the heart is going to come out of your mouth.
Amen.
All right, verse 1 says, then came to Jesus scribes and Pharisees, which were of Jerusalem, saying, why do thy disciples transgress the tradition of the elders? For they wash not their hands when they eat bread. But he answered and said unto them, why do ye also transgress the commandment of God by your tradition? I tell you, tradition is keeping a whole lot of churches in bondage. A whole lot of churches in bondage. God can't get to us because of our traditions. Now, if we're going to follow the Holy Ghost, let's follow him. If we're going to let the Holy Ghost lead the service, let's let him lead.
Amen.
But you can't cut short what he want to do.
No.
Several times in this Bible, we see examples of Jesus and some of the other apostles preaching.
Yeah.
Nowadays, if the preacher preached for more than 30 or 45 minutes, we're ready to go. But you know, I'll get on that a little later. It says, verse 4 says, for God commanded, saying, honor thy father and mother, and he that curseth father or mother, let him die the death. But ye say, whosoever shall say to his father or his mother, it is a gift. But ye say, whosoever shall say to his father or his mother, it is a gift, by whatsoever thou mightest be profited by me, and honor not his father and or his mother, he shall be free. Thus have ye made the commandment of God of none effect by your tradition. Verse 7 says, ye hypocrites, well did Esau prophesy of you, saying, this people draw nigh unto me with their mouth, and honoreth me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. And we have a lot of that going on.
Yes.
People talk a good game. They'll tell you that they're apples.
Yeah.
But the whole time, they're manifesting oranges. Verse 9 says, but in vain they do worship me, teaching for doctrine the commandment of men.
Amen.
And he called the multitude and said unto them, Hear and understand. Not that which goeth into the mouth defileth a man, but that which cometh out of the mouth, this defileth a man. Then came his disciples and said unto him, Knowest thou that the Pharisees were offended after they heard this saying? But he answered and said, Every plant which my heavenly Father hath not planted shall be rooted up. Let them alone. They be blind leaders of the blind. And if the blind lead the blind, both shall fall into the ditch. So his disciples standing by kind of scared. Aren't you afraid of the Pharisees? But you offending them. Well, if you preaching the word like what it's supposed to be preached, that's what's going to happen. Everybody's not going to accept this gospel. Their hearts weren't right.
Yes.
Now you'd have thought if the Pharisees didn't like Jesus and they didn't like what he was preaching, seemed like to me they should have just got on about their business. If you think you're right, go do what you do. If you think you're right, then go and build up your own kingdom. If you think you can do it better than me and your doctrine is right, go do it. Go do it on your own. But the Pharisees had a spirit. Their heart wasn't right. And instead of them, and to me, they had to know that they wasn't right, because if they were right, if they seemed like to me, if they thought they were really right, they'd have just continued on with what they were doing. But instead, they wanted to stand by and criticize Jesus for what he was teaching. So, well, verse 15 says, Then answered Peter and said unto him, Declare unto us this parable. And Jesus said, Are ye also yet without understanding? Why? Because if your heart ain't right, you're not going to understand the word of God.
Amen.
He'll hide it from you.
Right.
He will hide his word from you. He's not going to pour his wisdom out on a wicked heart. Verse 17 says, Do not yet understand that whatsoever entereth in at the mouth goeth into the belly, and is cast out into the draught. But those things which proceed out of the mouth come forth from what? And they defile the man. Why? Because if you take in poison in your body, that's what's going to defile you. It's sitting in there. And your body will try to throw it up. You see? And that's the way it is with the heart. If you take in poison into your heart, after a while it's going to start coming up and you're going to start poisoning other people with it. Right, verse 19 says, For out of the heart proceed evil thoughts, murders, adulterers, fornication, thefts, false witness, blasphemies. Those are the things which defile a man, but to eat with unwashing hands defileth not a man. Every sin that you can commit in this world, every sin that you've done, it started first in your heart. It starts first in your heart. So if you get your heart right, you're going to be right.
Yes.
Too many times Christians try to work from the outside in. You can't do that. You have to work from the inside out. Let the Lord clean your heart. You know, the Bible says that King David was a man after God's own heart. You know, God isn't like us. He don't look at what's on the outside. He look at what's on the inside. Because if the inside is right, he can work with you to get the outside right. When Jesus called his disciples, they weren't what they turned out to be at first. But their heart was right. And how do I know that? Because when Jesus said, follow me, they followed him. So they at least had a willing heart to follow Jesus. And from that, God worked with them to get them to where what you see in Acts and all the other epistles.
Yes. Yes.
But first, their heart had to be right.
Yes.
I say again, he didn't go to the Pharisees to start up his little bunch.
No.
All right, let's turn to the 13th chapter of Matthew now. Let's get back to the 13th chapter of Matthew. We want to talk about talk on this parable, the parable of the sower. Now, it's important, I'm stressing this because it's important that for us to have the right heart. Because if we don't have the right heart, we won't receive the word of God.
Right.
We won't receive it. Verse 1 says, the same day went Jesus out of the house and sat by the seaside. And great multitudes were gathered together unto him, so that he went into a ship and sat. And the whole multitude stood on the shore. And he spake many things unto them in parables, saying, behold, a sower went forth to sow. And when he sowed, some seeds fell by the wayside. And the fowls came and devoured them up. Some fell upon stony places, where they had not much earth, and forthwith they sprung up, because they had no deepness of earth. And when the sun was up, they were scorched, and because they had no root, they withered away. And some fell among thorns, and the thorns sprung up and choked them. But other fell into good ground, and brought forth fruit, some an hundredfold, some 60-fold, and some 30-fold. Who hath ears to hear, let him hear. Verse 10 says, and the disciples came and said unto him, why speakest thou unto them in parables? Verse 11 says, and he answered and said unto them, because it is given unto you to know the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven, but to them it is not given. Well, why wasn't it given to other people? Because they heart. They didn't have the heart to receive it. If I had a watermelon seed up here, and I dropped it down on that table, I can water it, I can do all those things to it that farmers do. But because it's on that table, that seed isn't going to sprout up.
No.
And that table is what a lot of our hearts are like. Hard-hearted.
Yes.
When I was a little boy, me and my daddy used to sit on the porch and eat watermelon. And we'd spit the seeds out on the ground, you know, sitting there on the edge of the porch there. We spit the seeds on the ground. And a few days later, you come outside and those little plants are growing. Why? Because that ground was ready to receive the seeds.
Yes.
See, if we want to receive the word of God, we have to get our hearts ready.
That's what the ground
is in this parable. It's the heart.
Yeah.
Now, I want you to notice in those verses that I just read you, it wasn't anything wrong with the fella that was sowing the seeds. That seed went forth. Is anybody in here deaf?
No.
Everybody can hear me.
Amen.
So, there ain't nothing wrong with the transmission of the words that you're hearing right now. Everybody can hear me. But everybody ain't going to receive it. Everybody ain't going to receive it. Verse 12 says, for whosoever hath, to him shall be given, and he shall have more abundance. But whosoever hath not, from him shall be taken away, even that he hath. I want to stop right there for a second. I'd like to straighten that scripture or the interpretations that I've heard, because I've heard so many preachers take this scripture and try to put money with it. I've heard a lot of preachers preach on this scripture and they think it's talking about material possessions. Whosoever hath, God will give more to them. That's not talking about material possessions. That's talking about understanding.
Yeah.
Whosoever hath understanding, God will give them more understanding.
Right.
Whosoever don't have it, God will take away that little bit that they do have.
Right.
Verse 13 says, therefore I speak to them in parables, because they seeing, see not, and hearing, they hear not, neither do they understand. And in them is fulfilled the prophecy of Esaias, which saith, by hearing ye shall hear, and shall not understand, and seeing ye shall see, and shall not perceive. Now, it'd be like, it's no different if I was up here speaking in French. And y'all all English, and nobody in here understand French. Y'all can hear me, but you don't understand.
Amen.
You can hear me loud and clear,
yeah,
but you won't understand it. Why? Because I'm speaking a different language.
Amen.
Well, it's time for the church of God to learn the language of God.
Yeah.
And to prepare their hearts to receive the word of God.
Amen.
That's the only way you're going to grow.
Yeah.
All right. Verse 15 says, "For this people's heart is waxed gross, and their ears are dull of understanding, and their eyes they have closed. They have closed, lest at any time they should see with their eyes and hear with their ears and should understand with their heart." See, it's with your heart that you understand. "And should be converted, and I should heal them. But blessed are your eyes, for they see, and your ears, for they hear. For verily I say unto you, that many prophets and righteous men have desired to see those things which ye see, and have not seen them, and to hear those things which ye hear, and have not heard them."
Yeah.
So I don't think we know how blessed we are. God raised up a lot of men in His Old Testament.
Yes.
That did not see the glory of God like what we can see today.
Amen.
They didn't live on this side of the cross.
Amen.
No matter how good Abraham was, he couldn't receive the salvation like what we could. Now,
Amen.
Now he was saved by his own. He was righteous because he believed God.
Yeah.
But there was still a trap door there that it took Jesus, the blood of Jesus, to open.
Yeah.
And so we're blessed to be able to see the salvation of the Lord.
All right.
We take it for granted because we didn't live back then. And we don't see what all those people had to go through to even come in before God's presence.
Yeah.
It's a blessing for us to be able to go to God one-on-one.
Right.
You don't have to go through a man.
Right.
Back in the old covenant, they had to go through a man to get to God. One of these days, if the Lord say the same, I'll expand on what all these people had to go through. But one of the main things, when it was time to offer up the yearly sacrifice, and the priest himself, of course, wasn't right. So he had to offer up a sacrifice for himself. And when it came time, now it was basically three parts, main parts, to the temple of God. You know, to the building in the Old Covenant. And God himself, the glory of God, dwelled in the Holy of Holies.
Yes. Yes.
And when the priest, and when it was time for the priest to go in and offer the sacrifice for the other people, they had to tie a rope to his foot. Because if he went in there and didn't cover everything that he had done, he would die in the presence of God. Why? Because sin can't dwell in the presence of God. And so we are blessed because there is no more physical temple like this building here. God don't dwell in this. He dwell in here. So we're blessed. And we shouldn't take that lightly. All right. Verse 18 says, "Hear ye therefore the parable of the sower. When anyone heareth the word of the kingdom and understandeth it not, then cometh the wicked one and catcheth away that which was sown in his heart. This is he which receives seed by the wayside." In other words, these people it's like talking in another language to them.
Yes.
They, you know, they didn't understand. Now, let's say, for instance, I might say a word in French. Now, you'll hear what I'm saying, and you might even be able to repeat it. But it doesn't mean anything to you because you don't know what it means.
Yes.
Now, years down the road, maybe you might take a French class. Maybe 5 years from now, you might take a French class, and then you'll start getting understanding, and then you'll remember the word that I uttered to you, and then you can say, "Oh, that's what Brother John, that's what he was saying." But this here says that the devil cometh and catcheth away even that which he would. Why? Because he don't want you years later to come into the understanding. He don't want you coming into the understanding. So it's important that we guard the word of God.
Yeah.
Verse 20 says, "But he that receiveth the seed into stony places, the same is he that heareth the word, and anon with joy receiveth it." So I see that every day, just about. I see that all the time in churches.
Yeah.
Boy, people can amen you. Hallelujah. I'm happy.
Yeah.
Well, Brother Buckley, he sure preached today. Thank the Lord for the word. They receive it with joy.
Yeah.
Now they, in their mind, they thinking, "All right, I'm gonna go out here and I'm gonna live for the Lord. I'm gonna do everything this brother said. I'm excited that I learned something that I didn't know before, and I'm gonna go out here and practice it."
Yeah.
Verse 21 says, yet hath he not root in himself, but he doeth for a while. So, you don't have, your heart ain't quite right yet. You got a little bit of soil there, but it ain't enough for that word to take root. So you might do good for a week, or maybe until Wednesday. This happened week after week. Sunday you received the word. By Wednesday you cussing and ready to kill everybody. Verse 21 says, yet he hath not root in himself, but dureth for a while. For when tribulation, let me stop right there. Tribulation. So when things are happening, in other words, when the devil come against you. Now, don't fault the devil, because it's his job.
Right.
Yes.
It is his job to take that word away from you.
Yes.
It is his job.
Amen.
And it's your job to keep him from taking it.
Yes.
So what he gonna do is he gonna send you a little tribulation. You gonna, I give you an example. You might go home. Before you even get to that stop sign out there, you receive the word with joy. Hallelujah! I'm gonna do everything Brother John was saying today. I'm gonna take it to heart. I'm gonna do it. You get outside, and you want to go somewhere and eat. Now your wife want to go to McDonald's. You want to go to Burger King. Y'all get to arguing and fight with one another. All right, then the devil done got you.
Yeah.
He done got you. Because you done forgot what you learned in here. You poke your lip out and go do what your wife want to do. And all the time in your heart, you know, you're upset.
Yeah.
And he done took the word from you just that quick. Before you get out of these church doors, he can get it if you let him.
Yeah.
He can get it. Some of you right now, you're probably thinking about what you're going to cook when you go home. Some of you thinking about the Saints, if they're going to play on TV or not, if they're going to be shown on TV or not. Some of you even got enough nerve to pray that the Saints win. I'm telling you, I'm talking from experience. I used to go to church, and I'd be thinking about, Lord, I got to go home and change the oil. I got to go home and do this. The whole time, I'm missing what the preacher's saying. So it's important when we come to church empty.
Amen.
Forget about all those things that are out there.
Amen.
God don't care about the saints winning. He care about winning souls. Because the saints plan ain't got no salvation in it. Saints don't care about you.
No.
You think they do, you just get a bill that you can't pay and try writing one of them fellas. See if they'll send you any money to help out. But you sitting there cheering them on.
Yeah.
All right. All right. I better leave that alone. All right. 21 says, yet he hath not rooted himself, but dureth for a while, for when tribulation or persecution ariseth, because of the word, by and by he is offended. Now I want to work on persecution arises for the word's sake. Persecution. What I read to you in the other chapters of Matthew was Jesus getting persecuted by the Pharisees. You know, when you believe the gospel in its purest form, don't expect a pat on the back from your buddies. You can forget about your support system. Because if the world is patting on you on the back, you better go look in the mirror and check yourself. Because the world ain't going to receive anybody but their own. So when you believe the word of God, you can just expect some enemies to arise. Some enemies. I tell you, I guess about 3 years ago, I was talking to my cousin. And she was just starting to live for the Lord. And she called me and asked me, John, I want you, her daddy's a preacher. And he's telling her she need to pay tithes. So she said, John, I want you to show me in the Bible. Just give me some scriptures where, you know, says I'm supposed to pay tithes. Well, at that time, I thought you were supposed to pay them. And I went and, you know, of course, I did like what other priests do. I started in Malachi and then kept reading. And the Lord began to change my mind. And I, you know, through studying, and I mean, I'm studying with an open heart. Because anything the Lord showed me in here, I'm willing to receive it. Right. Regardless of what my tradition is.
Right.
So, but I started out thinking, well, I'm going to show her the scriptures for it. Well, before it was over with, maybe 4 or 5 hours later, the Lord had shown me different.
Amen.
And felt like the Lord was going to want me to start preaching on it. And I was thinking, Lord, I'm going to be the only preacher in the world that believe that. So you just make sure that you got the angels posted around me. Because I'm going to be getting stones thrown at me. I'm the only preacher in the world. I must be crazy. And I told my wife that night. I said, Leslie, we ain't supposed to be paying tithe. She said, are you sure? And I said, well, I'm reading it right here. So now, we have to believe this word, regardless of what we've been taught all our lives. Regardless of what the general consensus says. Regardless of what the population and what's popular. Because it's probably going to be more people in hell than heaven. So, common sense tells me that if the masses is going with it, God is back the other way. So, I told my wife, I said, we can't don't do that no more because we'll put our place ourselves under a curse if we do that. And she said, all right. And I'm sure in the back of her mind, she's thinking he just done lost his marbles. Well, one day, I decided to call Brother Junior. And I imagine we talked for about an hour and a half that day. And maybe 45 minutes or an hour into it, out of the blue, he just says, I don't believe in tithing. And if you'd have been there and saw my face, you'd have thought I won the lottery. Because I started thinking, Lord, the spirit of truth is the spirit of truth everywhere.
Yes, sir.
He's everywhere.
Yes,
sir. So, you know, I can't tell you what we, now we talked for about an hour and a half, and I can't tell you what we talked about. That's the only thing I remember is him saying that. Because after he said that, all I had on my mind is, I can't wait to get off the phone and tell my wife I ain't crazy after all.
All right.
And if I am, I got company.
All right.
So, but it's good to know that the spirit of truth is the spirit of truth everywhere.
Yeah.
God's not going to tell his group something and then tell his other group something completely different. He don't work like that. So persecution comes with that. With preaching the truth and knowing the truth, it's persecution gonna come. When it came to Jesus Christ. His own brothers didn't believe in him until after he went back. His own brothers. This word of God, Jesus said, think not that I'm come to bring peace, but a sword. Why? Because this word of God will separate you from your family. When you believe the gospel, you got a mark on your forehead that everybody going to be shooting at. But you have to be willing to go through that. Verse 22 says, he also that received seed among the thorns is he that heareth the word and the care of this world and the deceitfulness of riches choke the word, and he become unfruitful. So you can sit under the teaching of Brother Junior your whole life. But if you got the cares of the world in your life, it ain't going to do you no good. Because the cares of the world and the word of God cannot live in the same place. Why? Because the cares of this world is going to choke the word out of you. If you're more concerned with this world and the things in it than you are the kingdom of God, then the word of God cannot abide in you.
All right.
And we talk about preachers and all them, you know, prosperity preachers that preach what they're preaching. But some of us done fell for it and we don't know it. Because we put the cares of this world before God.
Yeah.
We put the cares of this world before God. And you know, just to test yourself, you just think about this. What are you willing to part with for the word's sake? Sometimes we have to cut the TV off so that God can talk to us. Sometimes we have to get in the room by ourselves so that God, because God ain't going to talk over your television. He ain't going to yell at you over the football game. If you want to hear God, you have to take time out for that. Now all of us, we want the blessings of Abraham, and we want to be used by God, like what these people in this Bible were used.
Yeah.
But these people sacrificed.
Yes.
These people sacrificed.
Amen.
And here we thinking we can have our cake and eat it too. Some of us will sit in front of the TV with the TV on, trying to keep up with the game and read some scriptures at the same time. God ain't, you ain't got to worry about getting nothing from God. It takes sacrifice. And we have to prepare in the here and now. We have to prepare to receive God now. Because when you get on that other side, it's going to be too late. Whatever state you die in, that's how you're going to wake up. Let's think about it like a marriage. How many of you men, or I say women, because it's more done to them than it's most likely done to them. How many of you women would love your husband and just be in love with him if he came home from work and didn't say anything to you, but yet he's sitting there expecting his food on his plate? You say hello to him, he doesn't respond, and he do that week in and week out. That ain't no relationship, is it? And you probably wouldn't last long in that relationship. That woman would get tired of you, because she wants somebody that when she talk to them, they gonna talk back and they gonna listen to what they got to say. What's the same way in your spiritual marriage? You have to be willing to sit and listen to God, because God ain't gonna just keep going one way. It's got to be some feedback too. So the riches of this world, the care of this world, and the deceitfulness of riches choke the word, and he become unfruitful. So he got the word in him, but he also got the world in him. And the bottom line is, we have to make a decision. What are we going to follow? A lot of people are deceived and lukewarm, thinking they can do both. They try to balance the world in this hand and God in the other. That's not going to work. We have to make up our mind. Choose you this day whom you shall follow. Because that lukewarmness will carry you to the lake of fire. Verse 23 says, "But he that receiveth seed into the good ground is he that heareth the word and understandeth it, which also beareth fruit and bringeth forth some 100, some 60, and some 30. So, when you're listening to the word of God with a pure heart, you're hearing it and you're understanding it. And that's what enables you to bear your fruit. That's what enables you to bear your fruit. If you will, let's turn to Joshua, the first chapter. Joshua, the first chapter. We'll start reading at the 8th verse when you get there. Verse 8 says, "This book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt meditate therein day and night, that thou mayest observe to do according to all that is written therein. For then, everybody say then, thou shalt make thy way prosperous, and then thou shalt have good success. So if you want the word of God to take effect in your life, you have to meditate on it.
Yeah.
When you receive it, then you have to meditate on it.
Amen.
How many of you think you could live very long if you ate food, but before you swallowed it, you'd spit it out? You wouldn't live long. You'd starve to death. Because chewing that food, it ain't going to do you a bit of good if you spitting it back out. And that happens in church every Sunday. People chew it up. They'll amen you. But as soon as they get out those doors, they spitting it out. They not digesting it. You have to digest the word of God. And that word, meditate, it gives you the picture of a cow chewing. And most of you've seen a cow chew. You see how they chew over and over and over. They'll chew, look like for days, on the same piece of hay or whatever. They chew over and over and over and over on it. Why? Because the more they chew, the easier it is for them to digest. And that's how we're supposed to do. We chew our food over and over so that when it gets there, it digests easy. When it gets in our stomach. And so that's how we have to treat the word of God. We should, in the beginning of the day, I believe we ought to study our Bible. Or at least pick a scripture and memorize that scripture. And when you go to work, just think on it all day. Just think on it. God, you'd be surprised what God will open up for you. Just think on it. It's like my little boy. I got four children, and you met my two daughters, Taylor and Treasure. I got two more boys at home, little Hawk and little Houston. My little boy, my youngest little Houston, he's about a year old. You can get that little fella a piece of bacon in the morning time for breakfast. A couple of hours later, you see his little jaws kind of poking out a little bit more than what they're supposed to be. And you look in there, and what he does, you give him a piece of bacon or a piece of chicken or something, he'll chew on it for a little bit. Then when he get tired of chewing, he'll just tuck it in his jaws. A couple hours later, you catch him, he'll be chewing on the same piece of meat. When he get tired of chewing, he'll tuck it back in his jaws. Then when he get to where he think he ready to swallow, he'll swallow it. You know, the Lord will show us a lot through our children.
Yes.
If we'll humble ourselves.
All right.
And receive. Because God can talk through anything.
Because
that's how we're supposed to do the word of God.
Right.
Chew on it for a little bit during the day.
Yeah.
And tuck it back. Right. And pull it back out. Chew on it some more. Because Joshua was telling us that's what's going to make our way prosperous.
That's, right.
That's when we begin to see the change. That's when we begin, that's when we begin to see the change. People that don't change with the word of God, that's hearing the word of God, they're not changing because they're not chewing on the word of God.
Amen.
Like I said, it takes more than chewing on food.
Amen.
To keep living.
That's true.
Now, what's more valuable to us as Christians, physical food or the spiritual food?
Spiritual.
Well, we better treat it like that.
Yeah.
All right, turn to Proverbs, 4th chapter. Proverbs, the 4th chapter. We'll start reading at the 20th verse. Says, my son, attend to my words, incline thine ears unto my sayings. Let them not depart from thine eyes. Keep them in the midst of thine heart, for they are life unto those that find them, and health to all their flesh. Keep thy heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life.
Amen.
See, even in the Old Testament, Solomon had a revelation that the word of God was directly related to your heart.
Right.
Verse 23 says, keep thy heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life. Basically, what he's saying is, keep your heart from seeing evil things and from hearing evil things. Because if you, I've known people in the past, I've known people who in the past have had bad relationships. And maybe the relationship that they have after that, they'll treat that fella or that woman with a tainted heart. They'll treat that fella like they were the ones that did whatever they did to him. Because they've been hurt in the past. This is what Solomon's telling us, that, and that's the way it is with the Word of God. See, we have to keep our heart pure if we're going to receive the Word of God. Mm-hmm. You know, this scripture is kind of like guarding the well of your heart. Your heart is like a well. Now, back in the Old Testament, or back in the Bible days, a well didn't have any height to it. A well back in those days was just a hole in the ground. It was just a hole in the ground. And so what it means when it says guard the well of your heart was, back in those days, they had, you know, farmers and stuff, and the cow or mules or whatever, they'd come around that well and they'd fall off into it. Well, depending on how deep the water was, the community wouldn't know that something that, you know, that animal that fell off in there and drowned. Well, all along, the whole town is coming and getting with their buckets and dipping water out of that well and drinking it, not knowing that it's a dead animal down there. And many of them died because of that. Well, from there, they got sense enough to start covering that well, and then after a while, they just raised it up. But see, that's how our heart is. We have to guard our heart so that we don't get offended in our brothers. Because an offended heart cannot receive the Word of God. That's what was wrong with the Pharisees. They were offended in what Jesus was saying. All right. Yes. And because of that, they couldn't receive the Word of God. Yes. So we have to guard the well of our heart.
Yes.
I know people that, you know, they've been hurt by people in the past. Yes. And they're sitting back waiting on the Lord to strike those people down, to pass by their house and do something to those people. Right. Well, if you got that kind of mind, he needs to stop by your house first.
Amen.
Because you done got offended and your heart is torn to where God's word can get in there and grow. All right, let's turn to Ezekiel, the 11th chapter. Ezekiel 11th chapter. We'll start reading at the 17th verse. It says, "Therefore say, thus said the Lord God, I will gather you from the people and assemble you out of the countries where ye have been scattered, and I will give you the land of Israel. And they shall come there, and they shall take away all the detestable things thereof and all the abominations thereof from there. And I will give them one heart, and I will put a new spirit within you, and I will take the stony heart out of their flesh, and will give them a heart of flesh, that they may walk in my statutes, and keep mine ordinances, and do them, and they shall be my people, and I will be their God." I'm going to read verse 19 again. It says, "And I will give them one heart, and I will put a new spirit within you, and I will take the stony heart out of their flesh, and will give them a heart of flesh." In other words, you can't serve God with the heart you was born with.
No.
That's why we have to be born again. Because you didn't get it right the first time. So let's read verse 20. It says, "That they may walk in my statutes and keep my ordinances and do them, and they shall be my people, and I will be their God." So I like the way Ezekiel did this. He had it in order. He's saying God's going to put in you a new heart. And once he put that new heart in you, then you can walk in the statutes of God.
Yeah.
Then you can walk in the statutes of God.
Amen.
Well, many of us fail that. We try to walk in the statutes of God with that stony heart.
Can't do it.
And it's not going to work.
No.
So I want us to work on, you know, on us getting a clean heart before the Lord.
Yes.
And having the right spirit before the Lord.
Right. Yes.
Bow your heads. Dear Father, we come thanking you for your word this morning, Lord. Lord, we ask that your word not return void, Lord, but Lord, we ask that you let it accomplish what it was sent out to do, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
Lord, help us to examine ourselves, Lord, to see whether we be in the faith, Lord.
Yes,
receive the
yes,
word, Lord.
Yes, yes.
Lord, help us to continue to learn your word, Lord, and help us to grow by it, Lord.
Yes, yes.
Help us to digest your word and not be hearers only, but doers of it, Lord.
Yes,
Lord, these and other blessings we ask in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Yes.